Hi, it's Larry Hryb, Xbox's Major Nelson. Welcome to the official Xbox podcast. I have some great news for everybody this week. Well, maybe not great news.
Great news?
Well, the gang is back. I mean, last week we had different folks, and now we've got the kind of the core group here. But here's the really great news. Everybody's going to join us this week. Do you know why?
How's that work?
Well, we've got some interviews later on. Malik did one, and Kelly did the other. So we're gonna, kind of everybody's here in the show.
You know, I was catching up. That's awesome. And Joe was really good too.
Yeah, we got to get Joe back on.
Let's have him do that.
Joe has the mean mustache and our Xbox Wire editor from the UK. We record this just so you guys know. Everybody, first of all, hi Rebecca, welcome back. I know you've been away for a few weeks.
Thank you. It's nice to be back.
I'm really excited to talk about where you've been because you've got some cool stuff to talk about. But yeah, we're excited to have everybody back this week. Jeff, it's good to see you. We've got a lot going on this week. Got a couple interviews, like I mentioned. We're going to talk about what we're playing. I guess we'll start. Jeff, we'll start with you. I feel like we should start with you.
Really?
Yeah.
I deserve it? Well, thank you.
You always deserve it. You're always deserving of our time.
What's your angle here, Major Nelson?
There's no angle.
I just feel like you're being awfully nice.
Well,
I don't know how to trust.
So it's not so much what my angle is with you; it's more with Rebecca because I know she has something to talk about, and I want her to go kind of. Towards the end.
So saving the best for last.
Exactly.
Therefore, the inverse is also true. Got it.
Exactly.
Should have just stopped while you were ahead, Jeff.
I should have.
Since you asked,
this is great. So you know, I've talked about it in recent weeks. I've been very into both Resident Evil 4, where I'm taking my time, but it's really good. I really love it. And then also Midnight Suns, which is a game that I'd gotten back into over the course of the last few weeks. I hit the 40-hour mark, and actually last night I had this big climactic battle. Most of the time you're bringing three characters in. This was like a major two-stage battle with like two groups of three, and I was like, yeah, this is it. We're getting to the end here. And then after that battle, I was like, end of chapter one. And I was like, I'm sorry, what?
40 hours for chapter one?
Wow.
Are you being
a completist? Like, are you finding everything?
I've been doing a lot of side stuff. There's a few things I think I'm like ahead of the game with in some ways. And I was looking and they were like, there's three acts basically to the... big fan of howlongtobeat.com, which is built into actually the PC hub, the Xbox hub, but it's a great standalone site as well. Apparently the game is, most people finish it in about 60 hours that do some side stuff and whatever.
So chapter two, chapter three, chapter four is all going to come out at you rapid.
Chapter two, three apparently are shorter than chapter one, but it's a really great game. And I just am super into it. So you can even see the bones of where the XCOM team put little things in there. Even like some of the names of achievements are like sort of throwbacks to XCOM 1 and 2. So thoroughly into it. And between that and RE4, because I'm under the gun, because a lot of good stuff is coming really starting next week. So I gotta knuckle down. I gotta stop doing all this work stuff and just basically spend time over here.
Well, the good news is you're going to be gone next week.
It's true. I'll be on vacation and I'm going to be more traveling with, do I, I'm going to, I'll show you what I'm going to be traveling with.
Show me.
This is my little travel buddy.
Yep.
I don't know if you can go full screen.
Oh, I absolutely can. Here.
This is my Xbox Series S with my
X screen on top.
Beautiful X screen. And so all cool. I do, it, I mean, it's effectively like a chonky laptop. You know, you probably shouldn't have it on your lap for too long, but I have done it and, it works just awesome for like, you know, I just throw this into my backpack and I'm off and running and, I'll be, you know, we're going on.
Show the back of it. 'Cause there's an interesting design on the back there. Have you ever seen this, Rebecca? So it's kind of, so that snaps along the back. One of the USB ports plugs, this is the X screen, plugs into the back. You can't see it. So it covers it. And that's what's feeding the power for the screen above. Mm-hmm. And then you've got enough. Mm-hmm. That's your power port on the right. And then your memory stick, memory card on the left.
Memory expansion there.
Yeah, the memory expansion. So do you have it in there? I can't tell.
I don't right now because when I got home, because I was, you know, I was traveling for a couple of weeks, I just popped it out, threw it into my Series X that's over in that cabinet. And then I'm just going to yoink it and pop it in there. Although knowing what's coming up next week, I'll probably have downloaded Ghostwire Tokyo first so I can bring that with me too.
Yeah, you got a lot to do.
Nice.
Exciting stuff.
Oh, yeah.
You have a lot to do. So yeah. Anyway, nice to see your travel companion. That is it's fun to
I
have
borrowed that from Larry, so thank you. Thank you, Larry.
Yeah.
I've been borrowing it now for this is the 2 month anniversary, I think, of me borrowing that.
Well, and let's be clear, when you asked me to borrow it, I don't know if you know this, Rebecca, and you are welcome to borrow it as well if ever you're traveling. Jeff, I said, Jeff, what do you need? He said, I don't want to borrow it. I said, okay, what new games do you need? I downloaded all the games for him. I updated the system. Nice. I had it all ready for him. He just had to plug it in. In fact, so it's
that just, is very just
one,
generous of you.
One of the services I provide, I'll do the same thing for you, Rebecca. So that's
all. I might
got a whole loaner service.
Anyway, what? So you've been playing that? Do you have anything else on the back there? I can't tell. It looks like you're watching Ted Lasso with Apple TV.
I am watching Ted Lasso. Well, and then also MLS. Right. So you know, big Seattle Sounders fan. You can see a thing right there. I'm a season ticket holder.
Yeah.
And all the games are on Apple TV this year. And so actually, what I did last Saturday during the match is I was like, well, I'm using the Xbox to watch the game. So then I pulled out the during halftime, I pulled out the
side screen,
the X screen, and I used it as a little laptop, and I was like, so perfect. Yeah, I had COVID. I'd been testing positive at least for like the last week. So
are you still positive?
My family was like, finally not after like 10 days, and I felt fine the whole time. But my family was like, yeah, you stay in that room and don't even think about coming out because we don't want it.
Which just to be clear. That's like 85% of the room that you're looking at right there. It's not really
just like over here. There's a little pull out couch that we're like a guest would stay. I woke up, I came here, I worked, then I went over here, over to the Xbox at the end of the day, and then I went over there and I just went in a big circle
that was my life in my New York apartment though. So
okay, I got a feel for that. Like, yeah. This is what it's like to have a 200 square foot efficiency or whatever.
But, yeah. Well, I'm glad you're feeling better. And so, are you allowed to go back to the rest of your house?
No, okay. I'm testing negative. I checked everything. Everything's good now. I went back to the gym for the first time in a month yesterday, and I if this mic needs to be adjusted, my arms will not lift up to do it.
Because I see. I'm done. You're a little second. Okay.
What about you, Larry? What have you been up to?
Yeah. What have I been playing? You know, I've been playing. Cornhole Pro.
That's a game.
Have you ever played cornhole?
It's called
ACL Pro Cornhole, and it's on Xbox. Let me see if I can bring up the I don't know if you can.
Is there a way to play the game with one hand because you have a beer in your other hand? Because
it's, I don't know I, how it's kind of with cornhole. The stick, and it's I did terrible last night, so I was just playing. I saw this and I was like, what is this? And I downloaded it, and sure enough, it's cornhole.
Wow.
But the one I've been playing quite a bit, I've been playing Apex, Halo Infinite, gone back into that, of course, with their new season. But the one that has really grabbed me, and it's one of those, let me just play it for 10 minutes or 15 or a half hour. Dredge. Have you heard of this game?
A lot of people on the team are playing this game, and it has started to be talked about in some like in hushed whispers as like a bit of a, you know, a potential like game of the year candidate. So tell us about it.
Well, it's from Team 17. They did Worms and a bunch of other games, but essentially what it is, it's you have a little boat. It's all this third person. You're in a boat. At least it is. I've only played it for 3 hours. Maybe you get first person eventually, but you have a little boat and you have a series of tasks and you have to go fishing and trawling and you have to level up your boat and, you know, with a net and with the fishing and the lights and the horn and the whole thing. And you go
smoking
around
like a true seaman here, Larry. It's got all the parts. It's got all the parts that touches the
water. And you have to go and you know, there's a day night cycle and you have to go out to different parts of the ocean and there's, you know, and discover things. And then you have to go meet somebody and he asks you to go on some quest. So it's just, there's a dark, murky, no pun intended, side to this that I'm starting to discover with the story. And it's like, I went in, I was like, oh, there's a, I was in the evening once and I'm blowing my foghorn. And there was a response. It's not a multiplayer game. So I was like, oh, it's the exact same horn back. So I went and found it. And this boat was like, oh, let me go see what that boat is. And it basically turned into like this lantern fish and ate me. It was rather rough. So things took a dark turn, but you simply must play. There's a fishing mechanic of, you know, going out into the different spots and getting fish, whether it's deep water, shallow water, what have you, nighttime, daytime. Mm-hmm. And then there's the parts of dredging things that are under there, whether it's a shipwreck or what have you. So there's a couple of different mechanics. But Jeff, I could see this being game of the year because it's just different enough and it's wow. keeps pulling me back in. So I need you to go check Dredge out.
Okay.
So
my dad dragged me to go fishing so much when I was growing up. And then it's kind of funny that as an adult, I've been fishing in like Disney Dreamlight Valley. Animal Crossing.
Right.
I fished mm-hmm. a lot in Animal Crossing and then now Dredge.
Well, but there's a lot of
thought fishing. There's
there's a lot of things that happen when you're younger that kind of stay with you. So, I mean, my dad also, you know, he was a fly fisherman. So that was something. I mean, you don't fly fish in this. Maybe you do.
How do you catch a fly? I don't. How does that work?
Are you being serious?
Please move on. No, I'm not. Being okay.
I'm just letting it.
I just wanted that look from Larry.
You took the bait, Rebecca. I'm disappointed.
I should have known. Dang.
Anyway, so literally. Dredge is, to your point, Jeff, there's a lot of people playing it. It's kind of, I don't know where it's going. I'm just having a blast with it right now. So it's available right now. It looks, and again, it's not one of these games that is, it's 4K, 120 frames a second. It's just it's a cartoony stylized, but it's got something.
Yeah. It's $29.99.
Yep. It's budget priced.
Yeah. And it's, you know, it's optimized for Series X and S but it's also playable on Xbox One. And, so there you go. So I'm going to have to try that out. I'm going to download that and bring it on my
trip.
Like
it has probably a good story too, right?
Well, yeah, it's starting to, there's some characters in it and you have to do certain things and there's mystery and I'm upgrading. Now I'm trying to upgrade my net. I need to get a net now so I can go real trawling. But anyway, that's the one that for some reason is, you know, Jeff, you're a very interesting gamer in terms of, and Rebecca, I'd love to hear from you on this as well. Jeff is going deep on a whole series of games. I kind of do the same thing, but just one game. I just focus my time because I'm not held up.
Which is smart because
I'm not held up in a 200 square foot room, you know, under duress right now. Or you're not either.
Maybe that's the depth level. It's like Jeff goes really deep, Larry's kind of medium, and then I get bored with games after like short time sometimes. Yeah, and I move on. Thank you, Game Pass. Yeah. It's impossible to try a lot of different things.
Well, there was actually something that you had mentioned. Again, I was listening to the show with Joe and Malik a couple of weeks back when Rebecca and I were at GDC.
Yeah.
And you were talking about like gaming on a treadmill. And like, can you do that? And the answer is you absolutely can.
Yeah.
I just can't do it with a game where you control like the camera as well. Cause then like my real life balance falls off. So I couldn't play RE4 that way where a lot of quick turns, but a game like Midnight Suns, no problem at all. Yeah. So Dredge might be one of those ones.
Yeah, you may. Okay. You can swing the camera around in Dredge. It's not fixed. So maybe there's a way you can fix it. I don't know.
Maybe not. Okay. But it's good for JRPGs and, you know, sort of top-down like game strategy games.
A whole new category, games that are well played on a treadmill.
We should make a category on the dash. Like great for the treadmill.
Great for the treadmill. So anyway, that's what's really grabbing cornhole me right now. That. It's cornhole. I'm telling you, I don't know if
cornhole,
you know,
96.
There may be multiplayer, Jeff. I'll have to check. Rebecca, I don't know if you ever want to play some cornhole. We could certainly.
That sounds fun.
I'll let you look it up. I can't even believe I started playing it. It was anyway. The one that I do need to play, and we're gonna have an interview if all goes well later on. MLB The Show 23. It's an MLB 23, the show. I'm gonna play a little bit of that. So, Jeff, what are you looking up?
I'm looking up ACL Pro Cornhole. It just came out last week. It has real pro players. It's like, it's funny. It's like, it looks like a really nice, like set. Like I'm used to playing cornhole at like a brewery or in someone's backyard like there's uniforms and stuff like
There's lighting and everything's all marked off. It's legit.
Yep. You can use personalities, Trey Ryder and Bernie Neighbors.
Yeah. Trey is not happy with me. I failed him last night. I'm just telling you right now, Trey, I'm sorry.
All right. I'm peaked. My interest is peaked here.
Anyway, so that's my Rebecca. You've had a chance to play something. Let's talk about what you're playing. But I know one of the things you want to talk about is Minecraft Legends.
Yeah. So, spoiler alert, I've been playing Minecraft Legends, as has Jeff. So that's where I've been the last couple of weeks. You know, Minecraft Legends is coming out really soon, Tuesday, April 18th.
It's almost here.
And I know. And so for the first time since before the pandemic, we took this game on the road and we held like different like demo events and we invited press and influencers to come and play the game and capture the gameplay footage. And I think we're starting to see some of that pop up this week. But the demo experience was really cool because we invited people to play an hour of the campaign. And kind of like get the feel for how the mechanics work. You know, it's not like Minecraft where you're just like thrown into it and you just, all you can do is start punching trees right away. Like there are a lot of different, you know, kind of like resources and different like actions and things that you need to learn with Legends. And so we did an hour of campaign for everyone who came and then we put them into PvP matches against the people who were in the room. So we got some friendly competition going, which was awesome. And yeah, it was my first time actually playing the game. And I have to say, I really loved it. After the 1 hour of campaign, I had a hard time setting the controller down, but we had to move on to the PvP section. So, you know, but yeah, Jeff, what did you think of it?
I was really into it. It was one of those things where I wasn't exactly sure what the genre of the game is. And until, because it was like, okay, there's strategy elements, there's like third person sort of adventure elements. You know, normally you're used to playing Minecraft in first person. Depending, I guess it depends on how you like to play. And so I like how it started off with the tutorial. And for the first 20 minutes, I'm like, how do I do this? And it's really, you are in the battle. And I guess if you're thinking about it as like you're the quarterback in a way, like you're on the field, you're actively playing, but you're also calling the shots.
Yeah,
and so it's really cool. Like you have, is that, does that work? There's like,
well, it works for here in the United States. What about the rest
of
the country?
It works for here. I guess you would be the number 10 in soccer or something like that. Yeah, sure. Yeah. You know, you know, so things can happen, you know, in and around you, but things can happen elsewhere and you can direct people and, or direct, you know, your partner, right. Golems. And, now the thing about like when I'm, I do like RTSs. I generally like to play the campaign. I generally haven't liked to play multiplayer. But when we played Minecraft Legends at this event, I had so much fun in multiplayer, more than I expected to have, because it was really interesting. We each found like a role that worked out well. Mm-hmm. And one person wanted to just build the base and make these like really complex like walls so that if someone did get into our base, they would actually get kind of hung up trying to get where they were going. And one person wanted to go out there and get into, to, you know, scrums. I wanted to explore and find like unique like mining and other sort of assets that we needed to, for the person back at base to be it, because it's shared resources. So that person was calling out to me like, hey, we need more coal so I can build, you know, whatever it is that they wanted to build. And so I was going out, finding the coal and setting up the sort of harvesting operation there. And then occasionally finding treasure or other things like that. And then at the end, once we built up to make this like really awesome cannon that would shoot in, we found it overlooked.
The redstone launcher, probably.
The redstone launcher that overlooked the other team's base. Once we had built up enough, we were basically holding off the other team as best we can while we were basically saving up for this. And then once we got that, we all agreed we're all just going to defend that thing and let it do its thing, and we ended up winning, and it was really fun. So I could imagine if we had played a second and a third match, they would have seen that strategy coming and would have maybe done something else, and we would have had to pivot. But the fact that we were able to have a role that we were comfortable with was great, because I found like multiplayer with RTS, sometimes I'm a little overwhelmed. Oh, there's something happening back at the base, there's something here or there, and I'm just sort of like, I can't multitask well enough. That's not what this game was at all. Yeah. And I was in my comfort zone the whole time, and I really liked it.
In the campaign, you do have to assume all of those roles, right? But yeah, you're right. In the PvP, it was great because I don't personally care for building things. I wanted to just go and attack and collect resources. And so my team and I kind of we kind of huddled at the beginning and figured out like, you know, who was going to do what. it was a little bit tough because like the other team was in the room. And so we were kind of, like shouting like, hey, we need more redstone. And they're like, what do you need redstone for?
Yeah, right. Like,
not a redstone launcher. It's fine. But yeah, the campaign was really cool. I think I am going to have a lot of fun with that on my own playing. But you can also do campaign co-op. So, you know, Jeff, if you want to hit me up.
That's the plan.
Co-op. Yeah. Larry too. Sorry.
I want to, I just want to, go ahead, Rick, because I want to show the photos that you sent over so we can include those.
Oh, yes, please do. Yeah, but PvP, you know, you can do, I think, 2v2, 3v3, 4v4. And then there's also that element of the piglet, like PvE, because the piglins are also in the world and they're also attacking you while you're also trying to attack this other team and this other base. And so there's kind of this constant threat going on. And sometimes the piglins are a little annoying. It's like, oh, they're attacking the south wall again. Like, but,
right.
But you could harvest them. And there were certain materials that they would drop that actually you really needed. Totally. So if you, if there was a good balance of things, you know, going on there that I don't know. It really clicked with us very quickly. Our team, the red team, it was good.
The red team.
Or orange team, I guess.
The red team. But I want to just show Rebecca. You did this event and we, you know, back in live events, and this is, who do we have here?
Yeah. So, that's me on the far right there. So going, left from me, we have Jaime Limone, who is the marketing manager for the game, and
we've had him on the show
across. Yeah. He's awesome. I've worked with Jaime for a long time, Minecraft Dungeons, a bunch of other projects. Then in the middle, we have Dennis Rees, who's our executive producer, and he's kind of like the head honcho driving development and making the decisions and making everything happen. We have Craig Lee, who's our principal design director, and he was so much fun. I had a great time getting to know him, and he just brings this like fun energy to the preview events and interacted really well with the attendees. And then on the far left, we have David Fries, who is a release manager at Mojang Studios. And I don't think he works too much on Legends, but he is a great resource and super knowledgeable with tech stuff. And it was just awesome to get to hang out with them for a couple of weeks straight and, you know, travel. And we had all these kind of mishaps that happened. Like our flight to San Francisco got canceled. And so then we all ended up like needing to, you know, find a hotel room and, you know, chit chat about all the different like gaming events that we've done in the past and like funny things that people have said about us when we've appeared on like live streams and podcasts and stuff. Like we kind of swapped like horror stories of some like mean comments we've seen on the internet, but also just like really happy, like good memories too of, you know, staffing events and seeing the energy from attendees. And yeah, so the other photos were just of the event spaces. So
is that Lamar?
Was in
Jeff? Is that Lamar in that picture over to the left?
That is Lamar. Lamar Wilson. Yeah,
hello, Lamar.
Friend of all of us, actually.
Yeah, this is one of the events you did. These are press and influencer events. It's not like we had a public event. I just want to make sure everybody understands what's going on here.
Yeah, these were invite only. It's like, you know, we're going to get ready to send out codes for the game and let people play it at home. And so we wanted to kind of have that introduction and give them pointers direct from the development team, like give them the opportunity to ask questions and kind of get them ready to evangelize the game for us and like share with their communities, their perspective, their tips and things like that. And then this is in the San Francisco space, another press and influencer event. I'm going to miss that loft. I think
you see Snowbike Mike in there.
Right now, right?
Where is he?
Host of the X-Cast. He's sort of in the middle of the screen there.
There he is. There he is. Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, if you're watching this on Spotify or YouTube, you can see the video there. But let's get back to our lovely faces and we'll continue on here. Thank you. Thank you, Rebecca. Sounds like fun. We'll maybe, you know, we're going to talk about next week's show after the interviews, but maybe we can play a little bit of that next week if we have time.
Maybe.
I would love that.
Maybe. You're not going to be here, pal.
Yeah, but the internet is everywhere, even in Canada. They have it.
Oh, we're going to kind of drift into the news section right now, which Jeff, usually you handle that. And I don't know if you are up to the task this time.
Come on, man.
You're going to move 3 inches over to the news desk.
How's he supposed to say no?
In your area.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Just coming over the wire here. This week we announced more games coming to Xbox Game Pass, as we tend to do. Minecraft Legends is, of course, one of them. You'll be able to play that on cloud console and PC April 18th. Of course, available day one with Xbox Game Pass. This week, you're able to play Iron Brigade. Do you remember this one,
Larry? Oh, I do.
A tower defense shooter from Double Fine.
I do.
That's coming to cloud and console, and that's available now. Next week,
it was called something else before they changed the name. This is a deep cut. I'll have to think about that.
Well, let us know what you you come back with. Ghostwire Tokyo, this one, coming from... Wow, okay. I know, I can see you have the gloves on, Larry. Ghostwire Tokyo is coming out on April 12th. We announced this one from the makers of Hi-Fi Rush. Very different game, but very much looking forward to it. It has a new update as well.
If you're thinking like, cool. Wait a minute, that sounds familiar because it's been on PlayStation, right?
Yeah, it came out on PS5 last year.
Yep.
Yes, so exactly.
For those people who think, I think that sounds familiar. Why do I know that? That's why.
Exactly. Yeah. So it has some new content. So even if you had played it before, and it was out on PC, it was out on Steam as well. So it's coming now to cloud, next-gen consoles, Xbox Series X and S, and also PC through, you know, PC Game Pass. So many more folks will have the opportunity to play it starting next week. On console, NHL 23 is now part of EA Play. So just in time as we're getting close to the playoffs here for NHL. And also EA Sports PGA Tour is in its early access trial.
Yeah.
And that is available now. The what?
No, you had this really, you planted it well, as we say in the business.
You know, let's just soak that in. A lot to play. A lot to play. Work on that backlog. Mm-hmm. All right. Now, Larry, you've got your gloves. So why don't we go ahead and go to what you've got here.
Okay. Oh, go ahead and read it.
Oh, I'll have more news. We'll come back to me, but let's break it up here.
All right. Here we go. Go ahead and read the, because here we go. This is what we got. Look at this.
This is where you put in some record scratches because this is the Remix.
Yeah.
The Xbox Wireless Controller Remix Special Edition. Now, this one's a little bit different. Why do we call it the Remix? Because it is partially made from post-consumer resin, so like reclaimed CDs, water jugs, parts of other controllers. And so this is to celebrate Earth Day this year. We've created a controller that features recovered plastics. One third of it are made from reclaimed materials and regrind. So because it is made with post-consumer materials.
Right here.
Exactly. So this is why you sort your plastics. If you look at the grips, there's some subtle variations, swirling, markings, texturing. Each one of these controllers is actually going to look different than other ones. So if you put two next to each other.
That is so cool.
Yeah. So it's a subtle variation. They're all going to be green and various shades of green, but there are some just subtle variations that you'll see throughout actually the controller as well.
Yep.
I do as well.
Go ahead, Jeff. Keep going. Because there's another interesting thing about this.
Exactly. We also are including an Xbox rechargeable battery pack. Xbox is exploring ways to use less plastic and reduced waste.
Oh, that's
so
great.
This has what you might know as the Play and Charge kit. I'm a big fan of those. And so you can just put that in instead of AA batteries. Yep. And
you're good to go.
It will a significant amount of battery life, up to 30 hours of battery life per charge. And you can charge it up by plugging in a USB-C. And so you can play it while it's charging. It'll take about 4 hours to get up to a full charge. And
that's why they call it the Play and Charge kit.
Exactly. So it's a little out of focus there, but it works. And and as of course, like all Xbox Series X and S controllers, it's got both Bluetooth technology, so you can play on PC as well as the Xbox proprietary.
Oh, hey, by the way, I just noticed that design we saw on the grips. It actually also exists on the
The battery cover there.
No, on the grips. I mean, it has it on the grips, but it also has it on the triggers.
Oh, nice.
Oh, on the triggers.
Yeah, the bumpers and on the triggers, you have some of that as well. So,
they rejected my original headline, which is this controller is trash because you get it made with recycled materials.
I like that.
Provocative. It's actually a really nice controller.
And they properly rejected your idea.
Yeah, this is why I'm not in.
I guess we didn't want to see the headlines. Xbox released a trash controller.
But in a good way. Anyway, so because this does include that wireless battery kit, this is going to be an MSRP of $84.99. Will it be released April 18th? And so check your local retailer for product availability in your region.
Very there cool. we go. I got to tell you guys, I mean, I've always got the white gloves out, and a lot of it is for controllers. I have so many controllers in this office. I mean, I just should, you can see many of them back here. Those are the elites we talked about last week.
We can't because you're not full screen.
We should just completely, you can see some of them there, back here. I should just take this TV away and just put in a wall of controllers. It's just, it's,
you should
it's,
do that. They're suitable for framing.
They're beautiful.
I have a few on
all of them are well. Just, they're beautiful little Fabergé eggs unto themselves. So moving right along, what else you got, Jeff?
Yeah, just a few other bits here. Some updates to some big games. One is No Man's Sky. The Interceptor update is the largest new update in recent memory. Yeah, I think you kind of have to say that because No Man's Sky has been around for quite some time at this point. But this is a really big update.
Is it like 5 years?
Oh, it's more than that.
Larry. The reason I remember is because when we started doing Inside Xbox, the first episodes when we would do them in studio, or this week on, remember the show we used to do?
So it has been 5 years, okay. And then the game had been out on PC, and I want to say it was out on like PS4
and PlayStation, right?
So it's coming up on 5 years,
okay.
On Xbox. So yeah, pretty good. So, but anyway, significant new update here, and people were talking a lot about it. We've got a whole story here on Xbox Wire from Sean Murray, who may know from Hello Games,
of course.
Yeah, Overwatch 2. Definitely been showing us support fans some love. First, we had Kiriko, who appeared, I want to say, late last year or earlier this year. Now, Lifeweaver has been introduced. Lifeweaver has some really interesting, I would say, game-changing abilities in terms of like being able to like grab members of your team and pull them out of danger. Yeah. Very interesting stuff. He will arrive as part of season 4 on April 11th. So next week. And I think that a good Life Weaver could be a significant boon to your team. Just looking at sort of comments on Instagram, people were like, all right, maybe I finally put Moira down, you know,
right,
for a change. So we will see.
I'm still doing the pharmacy meta.
Oh yeah, I mean that's good.
With Farrah and Mercy,
that's good. That's good for Farrah. It's bad for the rest of your team. Yeah,
I know. I even it out. Don't worry.
Okay.
I haven't really played much of Overwatch, but I really enjoy all the different like cinematics that they do for the characters.
Yeah.
Like the intros, they're really good.
Historically,
like a couple months ago.
Blizzard does those very, very well. Yeah. Right? They do them so well.
Yeah. And they've really carved out the lore, you know, for Overwatch, like significantly over the past 6 years?
Six or seven years.
It's been going on for some time. So another game that, an indie game that folks have been talking about is Meet Your Maker. This is an FPS game where you're both shooting, but then also using, you're also like crafting and raiding and building as well. So this is just something that I had noticed people talking about, and there's like a whole content roadmap. They're already thinking about these things. Definitely seems like really buttoned up in that way. So I want to try this out. So Meet Your Maker, build, raid, and upgrade. And that is, that's available.
All right.
And then we also had a member of our team from Xbox Wire, Mike Nelson, got to play Star Wars Jedi Survivor at an event that took place last week in LA. This is going to be a good game. We're all looking, the signs are really shaping up. And what I appreciate about this is that the dev team is really talking about, here are the things that people really didn't like. Now, we liked Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order, like a lot, but there were things like the map, for instance, that were a little bit tricky. And there was things like fast travel, which I think didn't exist in the game. And that people, they've heard all of this and they're taking it to heart, and it just really seems like it's going to be not just improving the things that are we were complaining about, but really providing a heck of a lot more. So I'm pretty excited about it. It's coming out April 28th. We have a lot of games to play. We got to catch up on this backlog because
next
week we'll be playing Jedi Survivor. We got to play Dredge. We have to play Minecraft Legends, which is coming out in another week, and then we have a week after that, or 10 days after that, will be Jedi Survivor.
And then Redfall.
And then Redfall May 2nd. And then Zelda's in May. Oy, and then, oy, I mean, oy, there's oy. A there's a lot of stuff. So
Here we are.
Exciting things. And then one last thing, in case you didn't have enough to play free play days, I just got this in PGA Tour 2K2023, Black Desert, Bravery and Greed, and the Elder Scrolls Online are all available for Xbox Live Gold and Xbox Game Pass Ultimate members to play from the time you hear this all the way until Sunday night. That is April 9th at 11:59 Pacific Daylight Time.
Did you cover everything in the notes as well? I'm trying to pull up the notes in front of me here because I know there were some things.
Actually, there's a big spring sale going on until 4/20. No joke. Save up to 60% on select Xbox digital games, PC games. There are Xbox Series X bundles. There are savings on Xbox controllers. 50% on select movies and TV shows. Like, there's a lot of stuff going on there. And then there's a game called an expansion for Age of Empires 2 Definitive Edition. It's coming out in May 16th. That was announced. This is breaking news. Return of Rome. It is unlike previous DLCs. And so now we're up to 16 original civs, many other surprises. So there's a lot going on here. I will have to try that out.
Yeah, we'll have to get somebody on to talk about Age of Empires Rome. So.
They're basically bringing Age 1 into Age 2.
Right.
So it's all 16 original civs from age one will be coming into age two. So that's
there's actually a lot.
Pretty unprecedented. Yeah.
There's
pretty
a lot. Cool. All right. We've got to get to some interviews and then we'll come back on the other way and tell you about next week's show. Rebecca, if you would so kindly bring us into those interviews, I would appreciate it.
Yes, for sure. So first up, Kelly returned to the show and chatted with Chris Linn, who is the lead producer at PUBG Madison, and he came on to chat about PUBG's 5-year anniversary. Can't believe, has it really been 5 years? And then Malik of This Week came on to chat with Ramone Russell about MLB The Show 23. Can confirm it's MLB The Show 23 and not MLB 23 The Show, which is now on Xbox Game Pass. So let's listen in.
Hi, guys. Hope you've been enjoying the pod so far. I'm really excited today to be joined by, we have Chris Linn here, a member of the production team over at PUBG. So excited to talk with you today. How are you doing today, Chris?
I'm doing awesome. Really excited to be here. Thank you.
Yeah. So you're here to celebrate the 6-year journey of PUBG. That feels like it was just yesterday when PUBG launched, but also a lifetime of things have happened. Can you give us a few of your highlights of some of your favorite moments of the past 6 years?
Yeah, there have been a ton of highlights. I myself haven't been with this team for all 6 years, but remember plenty of the game fondly, plenty of the really large Steam concurrent users and all these types of things. But yeah, 2017 is when it initially dropped. I've had the pleasure of being with the team for a couple of years now. And, through the awards, the concurrence, all this type of stuff, it's just been crazy, crazy.
Yeah. And you've been able to try some new things with the game and with your like business model and a lot of different things. So I believe it was January 2022, you guys went free to play. Can you tell me what impact that had on your business model and how that might have changed like the player ecosystem and that kind of thing?
Yeah, it changed a ton. It was really great planning and idea to just bring Battlegrounds to everybody. You know, Battlegrounds for All has always been something that's been mentioned, and free to play just offers up so many more users, so many more opportunities, different feedback loops, different folks from different regions, content creation. It just brings in so much more and just breathes life back into the game, even for players that have been there for all 6 years. They get to interact with a ton of new people and maybe even friends they didn't have had the title yet. Free to play just opens all these doors. Really, Battlegrounds for All.
Yeah. Do you feel like the new players and the old players kind of mixing together and creating new strategies has led to anything fun? It's, always interesting when you're exploring a game you think you know everything about and you're always learning new things. So you want to talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, specifically in the interactions with the game. You're fighting and you're having these gunfights and you're like, man, this person's doing something I'm not so used to, or like not so meta. And then you know, that kill card happens. You're like, oh yeah, level 15, level 22, or, even that introduces to the high level players. Like, wow, there's this new stuff going on, these new types of players. I think for me, just like the aggression really went up. All these new players coming in, it just felt like matches just got that much more aggressive.
They're sweaty and they have something to prove. And it's always interesting to like see the game through a player's eyes where it's like, oh, I'm going to approach it aggressively rather than like strategically. And it does change a lot. So it's really cool to see the amount of players that are able to kind of get in and teach each other new things. Okay, so I am not allowed to ask you about any like major secrets, but I do have to ask if there is anything coming up for players in PUBG that we should know about.
Yeah, I mean, across the entire game, we're taking a look at things that can be improved, things that can be added upon via gunplay, maps, tactical equipment. I mean, we're really looking in game. Out game, we're looking at all facets and trying to improve upon what we've already been doing. A large part of that is looking at player feedback, looking at things that we think we could improve based on that. And it takes time, but I can confidently say with the 6th anniversary and this 2023 outlook and roadmap that we're really, really, really looking top to bottom.
Yeah. Is there an area or a particular update that you are personally really excited for?
Yeah. Without being too specific, but I've always been, a maps person, and the tactical equipment is very, very close to my heart. But maps, we've taken a lot of what we learned on Destin, our most recent map, and some of the things we wanted to try there with density and just buildings in general, and I could say that there's some stuff in play that we're really, really excited about for maps.
That's really cool. Map changes are always a really great shakeup, so excited to see the future for you guys. I do have one last question, but I wanted to ask first if there was anything else in the past 6 years that you wanted to touch on, anecdotal story, anything to kind of celebrate and highlight that 6 year journey the game has been on.
Oh, that's a great question. I always tend to just lean back towards the community and towards the creators and things that support the title. I can't reply to everything, but love to just watch videos and streamers and just see what folks are doing in ranked play or map rotations. But it's really, really driven by the players. We can look at it as much as we want to and the improvements we want to look at, but like over 6 years, it's just how many players have had impacts on this game, on this title. I know it's kind of corny to say that, but that's what I think of is our players and the people that really support the game.
Yeah, that's awesome. I love to hear that. Okay, so my last question was around the April Fool's event I believe is an annual thing, and it's still up until April 10th, and I've heard something about giant chickens. Can you tell me what that mode is and how people can kind of enjoy it?
Yeah, so this year it's like kind of a mix of a lot of things that we've enjoyed and the fans have enjoyed. Bizarre Battle Royale is back. Giant Chicken is back. There's a bunch of zombies. There's a bunch of stuff going on. You can purchase yourself some upgrades and just play. It's still last team standing. It's still, you can play with your friends and things like that, but it truly is kind of like a 6th anniversary thing, cuz it is some of the crazy stuff we've done over time and some of the stuff that has gotten pretty good feedback recently with like the bizarre stuff. So yeah, that's up for, I think until April 10th. So please go try it. It's a lot of fun. Free to play.
Yeah. We won't give too much away. You'll have to just go explore the giant chickens and zombies for yourself and figure out what that means. Well, Chris, thank you so much for your time today. Yeah. we really appreciate your time, and we're lucky to have you on the pod, and thank you so much.
Thanks. Hope to be here soon again, and I really appreciate it.
Take me out to the ball game is what you're going to be seeing when you play this next game, or maybe you're already seeing it because it came out on March 28th. Of course, I'm talking about MLB The Show 23, which is out now on Xbox One, Xbox Series X and S, and of course, day one in Xbox Game Pass. Here to talk more about it is, and I got to get this title right, product development, communications, and brand strategist from Sony, Ramone Russell. Ramone, how's it going?
It's going great. It's nice to talk to you, Malik. How you doing?
I'm doing well, especially since playing MLB The Show 23. I started it last night. I'm a little bit late to the pitch. I don't know. I was trying to make a really weird baseball pun there, but I wanted to. So I'm really enjoying the game so far. I wanted to start a little bit though with that title. I know I stumbled on it a little bit at the beginning because it's such an impressive title. What does a product development, communications, and brand strategist do?
I'm still trying to figure that out myself. Everybody here on the team, we all wear many, many hats. You know, not one individual does one singular thing. Like, we all have a lot of responsibilities. So it was just the closest title we could come up with that kind of encapsulates, you know, some of my contributions to the team. But, you know, it's a team effort here.
Team effort. Love that. That segues well into a team game, that being MLB The Show 23, which this is the third year that it's been on Xbox, and the fan reaction online has been it's been really impressive from the team's perspective and maybe yours a little bit. What's it been like being able to bring this game to Xbox players?
Oh, you know, we have the same goal as Major League Baseball. We want to bring a premium, officially licensed baseball game to as many people as we possibly can. And the only way we could do that was by being on all of the major platforms.
Yeah. And I think that it's all about, as you mentioned, bringing the game to as many players as possible. Now, when I jumped into the game immediately, one of the first things that you notice is kind of like the overwhelming number of options that there in this game, because there are so many new features. Can you tell us a little bit about what players who are jumping into the game can expect that's new this year?
Right. So we have a multitude of game modes. You know, we have exhibition, which is in every single sports mode, right? You know, you just go in, you want to play as your favorite team because you got a little bit of time. But if you have a little bit more time and you want to try to build the next powerhouse, you know, we have franchise mode. We also have a mode where you create your own character and try to get him to the Hall of Fame, which is called Road to the Show. We have this amazing online card collecting mode called Diamond Dynasty, where you get to play as everyone, and you get to build these crazy Frankenstein teams just by playing the game and unlocking more content. And we have a brand new game mode this year called Storylines. It's a new game experience celebrating the rich history of the Negro Leagues.
Yeah, and I wanted to jump into that a little bit because, you know, in preparation for this, I was like, let me jump in and play this. And I was like, man, I don't really know much about the Negro League, so am I the right person to do this? And then it clicked for me. It was like, that's exactly why this needed to be done, to kind of tell the history of the Negro League. So can you tell us a little bit? And then I would just want to quickly give my reaction because it was so amazing the work you did and kind of the detail that you went through. So it opens with Bob Kendrick, who is kind of like the president of the Negro Leagues Museum. And just the music, the B-roll on top of, you know, his very powerful words was like so striking. It just hit such an amazing tone. And then I jumped into the story of Satchel Paige. Can you tell us a little bit about why it was so important for the team to tackle this work?
Well, you know, the Negro Leagues is a very important part of not only baseball history, but also Black and American history. And you can't tell the story about baseball without talking about the Negro Leagues. You know, unfortunately, Major League Baseball had a nearly 6-decade long ban on Black and brown players in Major League Baseball. And one day, Rube Foster, the father of Black baseball, said, okay, you won't let me play with you. I will create a league of my own. And he and some other independent owners, they created the Negro National League. And it was a super successful baseball league for almost 40 years. And that story really hasn't been told. And that's why we knew we needed to create something special and different to specifically be able to tell those stories. Because as you mentioned, you know, myself included, a lot of people don't know what the Negro Leagues are and they don't know about the players and or how good they are. So if we were to have just thrown a Satchel Paige and a Hank Thompson, you know, into the game, very vast part of our fan base wouldn't know who the hell they are. And that feels cheap, that feels real icky. And so what we needed to do was create an interactive way to be able to do something very difficult in video games, which is to educate, to enlighten, and to inspire. And we believe we've done that with the creation of this new game mode called Storylines.
Yeah, I mean, when I jumped into it specifically with the Satchel page, it was the first one that I jumped into. It was really interesting how, you know, Bob Kendrick told like really interesting stories, like him not knowing when he was born or like nobody knowing like the exact year he was born. And also him jumping in as like one of the oldest players for their first, for their rookie year. And it's like these small things that add to when you jump into the game. And I think the first challenge is like throwing like four strikeouts in a game. And it's just like that added bonus of that backdrop really makes it so that when you jump into the game, it means a lot more. And then the small details that y'all did, like obviously the crowd wearing attire that you saw back in the day. And so it's just, it immersed me. Was it a little bit difficult for the team to kind of like jump into something knowing the amount of work that would need to go into this?
Oh, absolutely. This was by far the biggest project the San Diego studio MLB team has taken on. I had no inclination or thought that we would be able to launch it MLB The Show 23. I was thinking 24 would make more sense because there were just so much work that needed to be done. And when we first reached out to Bob, we didn't have a feature. We've been talking to Bob now since 2020. And when we first talked to him, there was no feature. We had no idea how to do this. We were just trying to figure out, you know, how do we start to build up a foundation and a knowledge base so that we can ask the right questions and have the right people in the room to answer those questions. And after our first conversation with Bob, it became readily apparent that Bob and the museum not only have to be involved in this project, but the entire project is really Bob and the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum. How do we use his story and his knowledge as a Negro Leagues baseball historian to put that into the game in an interactive way that makes sense for a participatory medium? Because, you know, that's what makes video games so special. You have the controller in your hand. You have agency. But at the same time, because the Negro Leagues is such a touchy subject, how do we immerse you in the Negro Leagues in the right way for an E4All video game when you're going to have the control in your hand? And so we decided very early on that we would tell the bulk, the vast majority of the storytelling before you actually go in game. And that's why we created these super cool, you know, micro documentaries that you'll see before every moment. That's why they're really short. That's why we added in all of this amazing artwork. That's why you see the archival footage and the motion graphics, because we knew as a gamer, we have to keep your attention span because you're just sitting there watching for the moment. And how do we keep you engaged and enlightened before you go in game? And that's why you see the super high production value for those videos.
I mean, super high production is spot on. It is like you all knocked it out of the park, not to use overuse a pun, but like it is really reminiscent of what you would see on any of your favorite streaming services. And I know a lot of gamers are maybe weary about jumping into something like this, again, to your point of, about around it being a sensitive topic. But I think the way you all handled it and how just pitch perfect the tone is, I was blown away. And so I'm curious from your perspective, what other storylines do you all, you know, this was called Storyline Season 1. What other storylines you all have coming down the line? Because I know obviously baseball, America's pastime, it's called that for a reason. So many stories that you could potentially tell. Mm-hmm. Any teases into what may be coming down the line?
Well, you know, because Storylines is kind of essentially a micro documentary series. That's why we called it Season 1. Normally, if you're watching something on your favorite streaming service, a season, they normally happen once a year. So that's why we called it Seasons. So Season 2 would be next year's game, if we're so lucky to be able to make one. And there'll be a brand new crop of Negro League players. And the reason why we called it Season 1 is we knew we wouldn't be able to tell the breadth and the depth of Negro League's history in one game cycle. You know, sports game development cycles are like 9 months. That's not a lot of time. And there's no way we could tell 40, 50, 60 different players' stories in, you know, a 9 month development cycle. So we sat down with Bob Kendrick and we thought, okay, so for year one, who are the first 8 individuals that make sense to tell their stories? And there's really no right or wrong answer, but we had to think about, you know, position diversity. We had to think about, you know, other legends that are being introduced into the game. We don't want to have like too many shortstops, or we don't want to have too many pitchers. We also want to save enough heat for future years. And we want to be able to use, you know, the superstar names, the transcendent names, to help bring up, you know, the other names of people that you might not know about. So people know who Jackie Robinson is. If you're at least mildly a baseball fan, you've probably heard of Satchel Paige. And so we use those two iconic figures to introduce you, you know, to some more iconic figures that you've never heard of, like the great Martin DeHigo, like the great John Wesley Donaldson, like the great Hank Thompson. And so that's really been our focus from the word go. And so far, you know, the response we've seen from Storylines has been nothing short of amazing.
Yeah, I mean, it has been impressive. Major kudos to the team at Sony San Diego. Just really impressive stuff. And I am sure you all will be back for next year. I mean, I feel like it's a given. But I wanted to switch gears a little bit and talk a little bit about face scan. Now, I personally have always wanted to be a baseball player, but hand-eye coordination is not so great. Athletic ability, not so great. You know, all those things that you kind of need to be a baseball player doesn't work. But with the new face scan feature, of course, you can put yourself into the game. Can you tell us a little bit about what this means for players and how it kind of works?
Well, it's one photo. The tech in the face scan app is absolutely amazing future facing tech. All you need to do is download the companion app for MLB The Show. Go outside when it's bright and sunny or in your bathroom when it's bright and sunny, and you take one photo and we build your face from that one photo. But after the fact, you can go in and you can change your hairstyle. You know, you can change your facial hair. You can tweak your skin tone. So it's really been an amazing piece of tech, you know, that the good folks at Sony were able to develop, and we used it to create the face scan app.
I love that. I'm excited to go in and make myself a World Series a superstar and go all the way to the World Series and win it. Nice. And make my parents proud for the first time in my life. That's a joke. Everyone watching at home. So really excited, you know, for what you all have done on the game. I want to kind of take a turn a little bit away from the game, but staying on the topic of baseball, because we know the atmosphere at a baseball game. You know, you hear the crack of the bat. You know, mm-hmm. you smell the food, the crowd going wild. But I want to go back to the food because I'm a big foodie. What is your favorite food at a baseball game? I'm curious.
Oh, man. It depends on the stadium. Depends on the stadium because, all you know, every baseball stadium, they're known for something different. Like San Diego, you know, it's like it's tacos. Like the tacos mm-hmm. here are amazing at Petco Park. The barbecue here is actually really good too, which is, you know, crazy. But, you know, if you go to Pittsburgh or you go to the San Francisco Giants Stadium, it's something else. And so that's also what I love about the different baseball stadiums is that you're going to get something different. And every baseball stadium, they specialize in a different type of food. So it's hard for me to choose one particular thing, but it probably have to be the hot dogs, you know, at Wrigley Field.
That's what I was. I'm a New York guy, Yankees fan here. Grew up going to Yankees and Mets games, and a simple hot dog with ketchup is kind of my go-to. But I was in San Diego recently and walking past Petco. I want to go to a Padres game, so maybe I come down here. You know, me and the team, we can just go out and watch a Padres game. How does that sound?
That sounds fantastic.
I love it. I love it. So, Ramon, this has been fantastic. Any last words you have for kind of the players as they jump into MLB The Show 23?
Oh, have fun. Lots of more content coming. And we're so appreciative of all the support from Xbox fans this year. And since we've been on Xbox platform, we really appreciate it. And we're going to keep trying to make the best possible baseball game we can every single year.
Thank you, Chris and Ramon, for coming on to the show and chatting about PUBG and MLB The Show 23. Good stuff this week.
I just noticed Pumbaa lifted Pumbaa his head up when you said thank you. He's like, yeah, well, you're welcome, pal. You're welcome.
Yeah. He thinks I'm done with my calls and it's time to go for a WALK.
Yeah, don't say that word.
Or he's you know, hearing about baseball. When I think about baseball, I think about the food you get to eat while you're watching a baseball game.
Baseball's not doing it. Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, we're thank you for everybody joining the interviews, our guests, and of course Malik and Kelly. It was good to chat with them. That's what I meant by having everybody on the show when I said that earlier. So nice. We're going to wrap things up because we're running a wee bit long, but I want to point out next week Jeff will not be with us. But that's fine. In fact, we're kind of not going to be with you either in this format. We're going to do it live. So Rebecca and I are headed into the studio. Last show we did was in February. We got a few special things planned for you. I think we're going to have, maybe Kelly's going to join us as well. So we're going to go into the studio. We're going to do a live show. So that'll be next Friday, which is, what is that, the 14th? Friday the 14th. Friday, and we're doing the morning. 14th. Keep an eye on my Twitter, and I'll make sure I tweet that out and tell you when you can join us. Love to have you join us. Probably have some stuff to give away as well. So, right, Rebecca? I hope. Maybe we should play Legends during that session.
Oh, maybe. I'll see what I can do.
Okay. See if you can get me a code by then. So anyway, all right, gang. Thanks, Jeff. Enjoy your time off, my friend.
I will. I'll watch. I'll put some comments in while I'm driving across the border.
Thank you. And then Rebecca, thanks for joining us this week, and we'll see you next week. Bye bye, everybody.